Hello, this is Gino, Gino Frarone. Hi, welcome to my show. Okay, I do have a guest here, Margaret Bassi. Would you be kind enough to, I'm going to ask you a few questions. Would you tell me first a little bit of a story before I ask you those questions? Something that comes from here. Tell me a little story.
Okay. Well, again, my name is Margaret Bassi, and I'm running for state senate. I live in Acton, Massachusetts, obviously, and I've lived here for 11 years, lived in Massachusetts for 19 years, and I have my family here. I've raised my family here, or I'm continuing to raise my family here. I have five kids, and my husband and I really love being here. And, you know, the thing about me is I've always been passionate about figuring out how to improve people's lives. And I've done that in various settings, in for-profit sector, in the nonprofit sector, and in the public sector. And I'm just really excited to be able to run for state senate, to be able to capitalize on that passion that I have.
Thank you so much. So now I'm going to ask you a few questions, okay? What town does the district cover?
So the district covers 14 different communities. So Acton, Boxborough, Littleton, Ayr, Shirley, Hudson, Maynard, Harvard, and Stowe, part of Sudbury, Marlborough, part of Northborough, Westborough, and Southborough.
A lot of walking, huh?
It's a lot of walking. We're walking all over the district. That's right.
Okay. When you talk to voters, what do you find are the most important issue?
So voters, you know, it's one thing that's been great about this is just getting to talk to voters. So, and I talk to voters at lots of different events that I go to, community events that I go to, and then outdoor knocking, as you mentioned, Gino. The issues that I think concern the community the most as I've talked with them really come around three things. And one is, you know, why do people move to the district? Well, it's basically they want access to good jobs. They want access to excellent schools, and they want to have safe and strong communities. Those are really what drive people to come to Acton, or to Littleton, or to Stowe, or to Ayr, or any of the communities in the district. And so those are the things that I tend to hear about. You know, with jobs, you know, people want to be able to have jobs that are nearby. Of course, people that live in this district, if you're working in Boston, as I've worked in Boston, you have a long commute. And you have some tough infrastructure that we've deal with, Concord Rotary being one of them, that we have to face when we're going to get into Boston. So you know, getting more jobs closer by, I think people are interested in. People feel like their sort of small businesses are getting squeezed, which makes it harder to have those local jobs.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So I think that's another issue that comes up a lot. In terms of our communities, there's a sense that law enforcement is not being supported to make sure that our communities are safe and strong. And again, those small businesses, not only do they bring jobs, but they bring strong communities.
Correct.
And that's why we have to support those. So I hear about those in both of those, about strong small businesses on both of those fronts. And then of course, schools. Everyone wants to have good schools for their kids. Again, I have five kids. I want to make sure the schools are excellent for them. But I think that a lot of folks are feeling like, you know, every time they go to town meeting, you know, the budgets are going up. People that don't have kids in schools anymore, or maybe never did, are feeling like they're getting sort of, you know, pushed aside.
Right.
And so I think that's an issue as well that we have to contend with, as well as making sure that our schools are really making our children or helping our children to become future ready for the jobs of the future.
Right.
So
very nice.
I think the other thing that comes up a lot, you know, besides those three issues, is that we have a current state senator who is really focused, particularly this last year, on a national issue, kind of at the expense of really focusing on what the communities in the district need, really kind of grandstanding on the sanctuary state issue that many people are not in support of, but also are frustrated that it's not an issue that they feel like is pertinent to the district. And it really feels like it's just trying to, again, grandstand on a national issue.
Question, you mentioned Sanctuary City. I'm going off for a second. Would you explain to people, a lot of people don't understand Sanctuary State. Would you mention why many voters will not agree with the Sanctuary State? Would you explain that?
So, I mean, I'll tell you the thing that I don't like about it, and it really comes back to supporting law enforcement.
Correct.
One of the main components of the sanctuary state proposed legislation that my opponent Jamie Eldridge has again spent the last year trying to get through, ultimately it failed just recently. It was pushed through many different ways and snuck through the budget amendment and all this kind of stuff, ultimately did not pass, which I think is a good thing for our state. But I think that the reason that I feel frustrated with it and is that it deliberately tries to tie the hands of law enforcement.
Right.
So what it does is it does not allow local law enforcement to coordinate with ICE officials or any federal officials.
Correct.
So ICE being the acronym for Immigration and Customs Enforcement Agency.
Yes.
So if you think about that, some people think about just the immigration part of it. Let's think for a minute about the customs part of it.
Correct.
The customs agents are the folks that are keeping opioids and other dangerous drugs and illegal substances out of the state, out of the country.
Right.
In fact, ICE agents kept out over 2,000 pounds of the deadly opioid fentanyl last year.
I heard that.
Right? So that's an enormous amount. That would comprise 1.6 billion doses of fentanyl.
So they mean for the illegal immigrants.
This actually doesn't have nothing to do with illegal immigrants. This has to do with just keeping out these dangerous substances from our towns, right, and from our state. And so by not allowing police officers to work with these agents, then we put that at risk. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's one of those things that, you know, oftentimes when you try to do all this kinds of legislation, you have unintended consequences.
Right.
And that's not a good thing for our communities.
The question is, what are the main differences between how you will approach this issue and how your opponent approach this issue?
So on this, the different issues that I hear from voters on the jobs and the schools and the strong communities, you know, my approach would be very different. So first of all, let's talk about the safe communities and strong communities. So because we were just sort of talking about something a little bit like that. On law enforcement, you know, my opponent really has a dismal record of supporting law enforcement in the state. And I've talked with, you know, several different law enforcement officers across the district. They're just very, very frustrated by this. So for instance, you know, he voted against funding for bulletproof vests for our officers. Now, if you've been following the news, which I'm sure you have, Gino, we had an officer killed in Plymouth a couple of weeks ago, which was terrible. We had two officers shot out in Falmouth last week. One of them was saved by his bulletproof vest.
Right.
And that's something that my opponent voted against. I think that was wrong. I also, you know, he's also voted against establishing mandatory minimum sentences for people that assault and shoot and kill police officers. That is not helping our communities to be safe.
Right,
that is not
right.
supporting our law enforcement officials.
Yeah, correct.
And then, of course, the sanctuary state legislation, again, would have tied their hands in not allowing them to work with federal officials.
Right.
So I think, you know, we need to support our law enforcement.
Correct.
And give them the tools that they need to do their job, to make our communities safer. On the jobs issue, you know, there's so much that we could do, even though we are in a good jobs economy right now, we're in a robust economy. There's some things I think we can do to support our small businesses. I've talked with many small business owners that are incredibly frustrated with what's coming down the state. They said, you know, the state is supporting big businesses and they're supporting unions, but they're not supporting small businesses by handing down these very onerous regulations that make it very costly for them to run a small business. Specifically, I think about the small independent retailers that we all love to have in our communities that make our communities strong, and we all want maybe our kids to be able to, our teenagers to work there in the summers or whatever it is, or during the school year. Those are important businesses. But things like the sales tax that we have in this state are making it hard for them to compete with online retailers, with our northern neighbors up in New Hampshire where they don't have a sales tax. My opponent has been somebody that has consistently supported higher sales taxes, and I don't think that's a good idea. He just recently voted against the sales tax holiday, which fortunately that did not, the sales tax holiday did pass, and we're going to be having it next weekend, which is great. We've brought it back, thanks to Governor Baker and other of his allies. So I think we need to support our small businesses more. Those bring jobs to our communities, they make our communities thrive, and they help all of us.
Right. I agree with you.
You know, on the education piece, I would love to see a couple of things. One, I would love to see reducing the amount of unfunded mandates that are coming down from the state to our local districts. You know, I, as a member, as a chair of the Acton Finance Committee, I saw these budgets and worked with these school budgets and the municipal budgets constantly. And a lot of what's happening in the school budgets is stuff that the school committee and the superintendent really can't change. They really can't do a lot about because it's coming from the state. We need to work with them. We need to support our local school districts much more. And I think we also need to just, as a state and as our local school districts, need to be more open to the different ideas about, you know, how to educate a child for future ready, right? To make them future ready. We need to do that more effectively. We need to be more open to new models, wherever they come from experimental schools, from, you know, private schools that might be doing different things, from charter schools that might be doing different things, from just other public schools that are experimenting with different methodologies. Mm-hmm. You know, if you think about it, our schools essentially use the same model that they've used for the last 100 years. And think how much everything else around us has changed. Right? And that's not to say that, you know, that doesn't put the onus on any particular party. It's just that we all need to work together to think of more creative ways to educate our children. So those are some of the things that I would do a little differently on those issues.
I'm really proud of you. Last question I want to ask you. What makes you a better representative for the Middlesex and Worcester district than your opponent?
Thanks, Gino. So a few things. One is, I think I have a very different style than my opponent. I have been known in Acton. I've spent 8 years in town government in Acton, and I've spent 4 years on the planning board, 3 years chairing the Acton 2020 committee, and 4 years on the finance committee, also chairing that committee as well. And in all of those years, I was always interested in how to get the most diverse input, figure out how to bring people together around common ground, and then move forward. And that was really important to me. In all of my different roles in town government. I don't see that from our current state senator. I see someone that literally takes the most extreme position on issues and stays there. And I don't think that's serving the district. I think, secondly, I feel like I sort of have more of the lived experience of many of the people in the district than the current state senator. You know, I've worked in all three sectors. I've run a household. You know, I've got kids, you know, going to soccer games and basketball games and in schools and all of that. And I pay a mortgage and all of those things. While our state senator literally has only ever worked on Beacon Hill. That's always been his job, is being on Beacon Hill. So I think it's made his perspective more myopic, right? He's really not seeing all the different things that are going around because he's not involved in any of those other things.
Before I forget, would you tell the public that you need help?
Yes, would love to have your help on my campaign. You can go to my website at www.busseyforsenate.com. That's B as in boy, U, S as in Sam, S as in Sam, E, the number 4, and then the word Senate. So www.busseyforsenate.com.
You need a lot of volunteers, or you need few volunteers?
We need lots of volunteers. Okay. We need financial contribution. Okay. We're having a lot of fun, and we're really going to take this right till November 6th and win this race.
Well, I thank you so much, Margaret. And I hope you, in the public, I hope you watch this, and I hope you understand the people have the choice. We gave everybody an opportunity to come to the station. It's up to the people in Massachusetts to make their choice. And I want to thank you so much to be in our show. This is Gino. Goodbye.